Yesterday, on my way to Givat Shmuel, suburb of Tel Aviv, I stopped for coffee at my friend Yoni in Rehovot. And I was surprised, but not really surprised, to find three of her young grandchildren with her. And it was such a pleasure to see her interacting with them. And this obviously leads into our subject tonight, even though she is not in her old age yet, as none of us are. But that is exactly what goes on here in August. The nurseries shut down and people, grandparents have to chip in. It's a difficult situation, but I trust much joy is gleaned from it. So tonight we reach old age. So I'm going to share my screen. So I'm sure you've noticed, and I guess there's a part of me that feels the need to acknowledge this, that not just in this series, but in other series, I will bring in not just Jewish thinkers, philosophers, rabbis, Jewish educators, but as Rav Kook has taught us, that we have what to glean from the secular world. And I truly believe that will be Mashiach Zeit when we learn from each other. So I don't know if this song looks familiar to you. Any, Gloria?
Yeah, it does, very much so.
Ah, who is the artist? Do you know?
That you can't ask me.
I don't want to put you on the spot. I was just curious.
I thought she was going to sing it. I thought Gloria should sing it for her.
Okay, wait. Then I wouldn't have a class if I started to sing.
No, do you know the tune? We're not going to listen to this one. We are going to listen to another one after that. Okay, so this is a creation of Neil Young.
Mm. Yeah.
And going back to the late 60s, 70s.
Right.
Yeah. And he says, oh, to live on Sugar Mountain with the bankers and the barkers and the colored balloons. You can't be 20 on Sugar Mountain, though you're thinking that you're leaving there too soon. You're leaving there too soon. It's so noisy at the fair, but all your friends are there and the candy floss you had and your mother and your dad. Oh, to live on Sugar Mountain with the barkers and the colored balloons. You can't be 20 on Sugar Mountain, though you're thinking that you're leaving there too soon. You're leaving there too soon. There's a girl just down the aisle. Oh, to turn and see her smile. You can hear the words she wrote as you read the hidden note. Now you're underneath the stairs and you're giving back some glares to the people that you met, and it's your first cigarette. Oh, to live on Sugar Mountain with the barkers and the colored balloons. You can't be 20 on Sugar Mountain, though you're thinking that you're leaving there too soon. You're leaving there too soon. What is Neil Young doing in this song? What is he lamenting?
His youth?
The loss of childhood.
Exactly. His lost youth. And Sugar Mountain is a symbolic location, symbolizing and idealizing youth. Now, did you know that Joni Mitchell wrote a song in response to Young's song? In a concert at the Albert Hall in London on October 29, 1970, Joni, a friend of Neil's, opened her song Circle Game with this speech. And I'm just going to read it, and then we're going to listen to the song. In 1965, I was up in Canada, and there was a friend of mine up there who had just left a rock and roll band. He had just newly turned 21, and that meant he was no longer allowed into his favorite haunt, which was kind of a teeny bopper club. And once you're over 21, you couldn't get back in there anymore. So he was really feeling terrible because his girlfriends and everybody that he wanted to hang out with, his band could still go there, you know, but it's one of the things that drove him to become a folk singer was that he couldn't play in this club anymore because he was over the hill, 21. So he wrote this song that was called Oh, to Live on Sugar Mountain, which was a lament for his lost youth. And I thought, God, you know, if we get to 21 and there's nothing after that, that's a pretty bleak future. So I wrote a song for him and for myself just to give me some hope. And it's called The Circle Game. Let's listen and look at the words that will be on the screen, please.
Yeah. Perfect.
Yesterday, a child came out to wonder.
Okay, well, for those who aren't, I'm going to just put the words here so you can at least read the words.
Fearful when the sky was full of thunder. The seasons, they go round and round, and the painted ponies go up and down. We're captive on the carousel of time. We can't return, we can only look behind.
Let me know when it's
over.
If we look at my screen now, so these last few lines, and the seasons, they go round and round, and the painted ponies go up and down, we're captive on the carousel of time. We can't return, we can only look behind from where we came and go round and round in the circle game. And right before that, she says, there will be new dreams, maybe better dreams, and plenty. So does our society embrace those words of Mitchell's? When somebody is the stage of life of old age, does our society really have that perspective that the elderly can still have dreams? Anyone?
I'm reading a book that relates to this very, very much by Arthur C. Brooks. It's From Strength to Strength, Finding Success, Happiness, and Deep Purpose in the Second Half of Life. I highly recommend the book. Also, there's a Toronto songwriter, A.B. Rotenberg, maybe some of you know him, who wrote a wonderful song that's on YouTube called Ride the Train. So the train is a metaphor for time. And he talks about how in some cars, people just think it's a joke, and others look at it more seriously because they are aware of the finite nature of life and how important time is. However, this song is a little more hopeful toward the end, and Arthur C. Brooks' book, From Strength to Strength, which I highly recommend, speaks about even greater fulfillment toward the second part of life if people know how to reinvent themselves.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you, Elliot. Yes.
I think it's a question of attitude. Can you see my Zoom? I'm holding something in my hand.
No.
Okay.
I only see four people in front of me and you're not one of them.
Okay. So I have a magnet on my fridge that says, age is a matter of the mind. If you don't mind, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And I really, as you know, I'm 90 years old and I don't feel it. If I look in the mirror sometimes, I say, who's that? But I have the time now. I never had enough time to do the things I wanted to do. And when you talked before about grandparents, and my granddaughter left her little one with me, and she said, thank you, Bobby. I said, no, I thank you for giving me the privilege of having the baby with me. So
absolutely.
So it's a question of attitude.
Yes. Okay. Anyone else? Well, the overall belief is that we live in a society that does everything possible to deny the oncoming of becoming elderly. We talked about in the context in the first session of moving from one stage to the next and us trusting that we take each stage with us. A rabbi, Zvi Hirsch Weinreb, loves visiting residents for senior citizens. At one such visit, he dispensed with giving a prepared lecture and instead asked a question. What made you first realize that you were getting older? He received two very different sets of responses. The first, I knew I was getting older when people started to ignore me. Then there was another set of responses. I knew I was getting older when passengers on the bus stood up for me and gave me their seat, an act that showed deference. Both groups unanimously agreed with the position articulated by the oldest person there, who said, we don't want gestures of respect. We want genuine respect. Now I would ask you, what would reflect genuine respect to the elderly? What would genuine respect for our senior citizens entail, look like?
Consulting them for advice.
Nice, Linda.
Respecting their opinions.
Okay, good, Marlene.
Visiting.
I have your kids, by the way, on another Zoom listening to your answer. Okay, yes. Somebody else said something.
Constant phone calls and visiting.
Okay, yes, Esther. Somebody else.
I'd like to add that I think in the first two thoughts that were shared, that I think in places of work, it can be taken to a degree of letting it be lectures. And I work in a medical facility, and the elder members of the staff who've retired can certainly be brought back, because what they have to share is priceless. Their experience, et cetera, and for them to be part of, whether it's teaching or medical rounds, and that's real respect. In yeah. my opinion, that's something that's very necessary.
And also, Linda.
I also think that them wanting to share, that they feel that they want to share with us what it is that they're in their lives, because we want to be a part of it, but they're busy. And so the need, if they say, I had this experience today, I want to share it with you, it makes you feel included.
Yeah. Baraka, you know what gives me great pleasure? Is knowing that the kids feel that I'm independent and I can manage my own life.
Yeah, okay. I'm sure that does, as long as they're the proper balance. With Linda's comment, I wasn't sure exactly where I was going to put this in, but I am now. But first I wanna say one word to what Nahama just said. It reminded me of, a rheumatologist that I saw in Toronto many years ago. And he was bemoaning the fact that he was a certain age and feeling that now he really has what to offer and to teach and his mindset, and that he now had to leave the hospital. And I could see the sadness in his eyes. Anyway, so we're familiar with the author, David Grossman, usually writing for adults, but as many authors do, they also write for children. And this book, and most of these books speak to the adult, just as videos or movies for children with a certain message grab us as well. So in English, the book is called Every Wrinkle Has a Story. And
that's a good title.
The Saba and his grandson, Yotam, meet at least once a week and they sit at a cafe and have discussions. Well, this time, the grandson, Yotam, is very curious about his grandfather's wrinkles. And he asks him, what are these from? And Saba says, you know, wrinkles are something that happen to people as they're getting older. And he asks, do they hurt? Do they hurt me? Yeah, he smiled, the grandfather. And he said, no, they don't really hurt me. Can I touch them? Sure, you can. And he puts his fingers on the wrinkles and he plays with them, and the grandfather laughs. And they go on talking, and he says, where do these wrinkles come from? And he says, well, because I'm getting older, and some of them are because of things that have happened in my life. Happy things and sad things. And Yotam says, like when Savta died, he says, yes, but yesh li gam kmatim acherim. I have other wrinkles, Saba says. For example, this wrinkle, I am almost positive that it began the day you were born. And Grossman is encouraging with this story what was said earlier, not just spending time, but really, really talking. And as Linda said earlier also, of the intergenerational feeling involved, and it's, I guess, mainly up to us to create an atmosphere where they will want to speak with us. And there will be times that they don't want to, and that's okay. Fine too, right, Linda?
Okay. Right.
Now, I want to ask, so the answers I was going to give are what you all just said. Just to say it just a drop differently, that they appreciate that we've lived longer, our life experiences, and that should mean accumulated wisdom. Not in every subject, but we know what I mean. So what does our tradition teach? So we have laws such as you shall rise before a venerable person, and you shall respect the elderly, and you shall fear your God. I am the Lord. And then in another sefer, it says, just a sec. Every man shall fear his mother and his father, and you shall observe my Shabbatot. I am the Lord your God. Now, there's much to say about this, but I just want to focus on our subject. So Rashi goes on to explain what is fear of our parents. And you know, earlier, the order was reversed. When it first talks about honoring your parents, it says honor your father and then mother. And that's only because honoring, I'm doing what I don't want to do, is that the father was seen certainly then as the stricter. And so it was saying you should have affectionate feelings for your father equally. And the mother, okay? Now, today, I don't know, it's a toss up who kids are more afraid of. Right? Okay. Now, but what does honor and fear mean? So Rashi says, I am the Lord your God, where your is in the plural form, meaning to say both you and your father are obligated to honor me, meaning that we're to respect our parents, but our parents also, like us, have to respect God. And that leads to, if they do something that's not right, we don't have to listen to them. But we're not going there now. Now, therefore, do not listen to him to negate my commands. What constitutes fear? One must not sit in his place or her place, speak in his stead when it is father's turn to speak, or contradict him, certainly in public. And what constitutes honor? One must give the father and mother food and drink, and that can be actually buying or actually physically feeding, clothing them and putting on their shoes, again, buying or physically helping them out, and accompany them when they enter or leave. Be a chauffeur. Now, Rashi goes on to explain that even though you are meant to physically, not contradict, help sit, help feed, and not sit in their place, that it also means much more than that. Like, what does it say that we don't sit in our parents' seat? We recognize that the elderly is still here, has his or her well-earned place in society, a valued place. And not interrupting isn't just to be courteous, it's an awareness that this older person has still, very much still, something valuable to say. And as we've said on many occasions, we need concrete reminders of these values. Now, let's go on to speak a little more about the ills of old age, both due to society's perspective that we've mentioned and to the older person, him or herself. So let's concisely say the sense of being useless to and rejected by family and society. And of course, there are exceptions. Two, a sense of boredom, an inner emptiness. And three, loneliness and fear of time. Now, these rules that I just read before you, that Rashi comments on, is that all we suggest be done to heal humanity of these ills? Far from it. Belle, please mute yourself. So what can and should one do for him or herself, putting society aside? How do we fight these ills? So, approaches to old age and suggested healings. And of course, the green, a symbol of growth, is not coincidental. So, a few words. We must ensure the elderly have a sense of significant being, a feeling needed. And if somebody wants to add something or contradict something, please. Okay, but I'm setting some, I think, most basic and necessary principles that have to be respected.
A sense of purpose in life and various stages in life.
Every stage of life, the sense of being a significant being should not stop after you are no longer employed. Absolutely, absolutely.
But Bracha, it works both ways. Children also have the need to feel needed.
Oh, but this doesn't deny that. This doesn't deny that. We're now concentrating on this period of time, which is inevitable.
Yeah, but then,
time is passing, and it's something that people really have to prepare for very early on.
That's
so
right.
That it's not this sharp break between how I've existed and what my priorities have been as I reach the older age.
In other words, no tunnel vision when you're younger.
I'm sorry?
I said no tunnel vision when you're younger.
Ah, well, there should never be. Okay.
Bracha?
Yes.
Hi, sorry.
Julia, hi.
I find this discussion particularly interesting. 3 years ago, my soon-to-be 92-year-old mother moved in with us. And it has been the most incredibly wonderful experience, not just for her, for us, for our children, and for our grandchildren, her great-grandchildren. And reading this, it's absolutely exquisite, because we are seeing daily this in practice with the little ones asking my mother questions about why she's got like a boo-boo on her face, or why she tremors, things like that. And her response to it.
Wow.
Never stop asking questions. For example, like if I'm cooking or whatever, I will always go to my mother and ask her opinion about, you know, a recipe and things like that. And interesting, her response has been that every age brings something else that's absolutely wonderful.
Wonderful thought. Wonderful thought. So this was shortly after I left that she joined you.
Yeah.
Wow. And so the modeling that you're doing, you know, there used to be a time that it was very common for a grandparent to live with the family. Kol hakavod.
It's magnificent, I have to say.
And what about Marvin? What does he have to say?
I'm okay. With her 100%.
I'm sure you are, Marvin. I wouldn't have said that if I didn't trust you were. Okay, so let's go on. Thank you, Julia. Old age.
Racha, you know, but that can also create a problem. My mother-in-law moved in with me. And then when I entertained, I asked her to come and join us. And she said, no, those are not, I don't want to disturb yours. And it created, it was a wonderful experience. She was with me for a couple of years. But it created sometimes, like when I had company and she didn't want to join us, and I felt uncomfortable about it.
Yeah, no, of course, there will be moments like that, but overall, if it's your choice, but you go on with your own life and don't have to feel guilty. If she makes a choice, she doesn't have to be a part of every moment in your home. You talked about independence earlier. Okay, so Avram Yoshua Heschel says the following. I neglected to put his name. Old age has the vicious tendency of depriving a person of the present. The aged thinks of himself or herself as belonging to the past, but it is precisely the openness to the present that he must strive for. The marvel is discovered in, that should be, celebration. He or she who lives with a sense for the present knows that to get older does not mean to lose time, but rather to gain time. You're in the moment. We appreciate what we share, as a few of you have just said. We do not appreciate what we receive. We do, but you know what he means. It is for parents to inspire, to convey his or her moments of insight. And hence, so much of our Torah speaks of asking parents and the parent being instructed to tell the children, not for the sake of ordering, but speaking, and of course, the Haggadah, sharing time that includes having fun, but also talking. Generations must be interconnected. Now, John Kotra gives us a term, generativity. What is that? To invest one substance in forms of life and work that will outlive the self, again, to invest one substance in forms of life and work that will outlive the self. And this has been a theme of ours over the last over two years of living with an awareness of ideals and beliefs and focus beyond the me. But there's nothing wrong in wanting to leave something of me behind. You do this, and that will outlive your physical self. And keeper of the meaning. Being a keeper of the meaning means handing on the values of the past to the future. Age brings the reflection and detachment that allows us to stand back and not be swept along by the mood of the moment or passing fashion or the madness of the crowd. We need that wisdom, especially in an age as fast-paced as ours, where huge success can come to people still quite young. And life is over when you've achieved that kind of success. As Joni Mitchell says, that would be sad at 21. Now.
But it can be also very dangerous, Bacha. People who reach success too early in young lose some basic values.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely, yeah. Now, Heschel goes on to suggest that we have to revive the equation of old age and wisdom. Now, before I go on, why do you think, even when he said this some decades ago, he felt that old age was not seen as equated with wisdom? Why?
Well, it depends what kind of a life you lived.
No, but on society's part, that there is a tendency to feel again that when somebody reaches a certain age, that that is not somebody, as a few of you said, that you go to consult with, that you feel, ah, how is this?
Because Bracha,
Linda,
the media and society in general has made a god of youthfulness. You know, you don't want to have wrinkles, you don't want to get gray, and the young people they're all the idols. So it's hard to counteract that.
But Torah teaches us differently.
Yes, okay, and it is a big responsibility, but it is our task and others too, to fight what Linda just described. Absolutely. Now,
but Torah says experience.
Besides that, society put into place compulsory retirement ages, and people you came to 65 and goodbye. It was goodbye. It was like the rheumatologist that you spoke to, whose mind was still quite active and who was still learning and had much to impart. And yet he was going to be forced to leave his position at the hospital. And that was happening all over the place. The only place that did not happen, I have to tell you, and for a very good reason, was when I was working at Baycrest, there never was a compulsory retirement age because that would have gone against their reason for being there.
I think I know of a rabbi at a major conservative synagogue who was well respected and could no longer sit on the bima when he was retired. He was offended by that, and connected with another shul.
Yeah, that's another issue, and that was sad.
May I say something?
Loretta, yes.
I think there's another element here. If we look at transitional stages in our lives over a longer period, when there's new innovation, people seem to think the older people, and it's often true, that we harder as we age, it's harder to make change and to adapt to some new situation. Now, particularly with the technological revolution or advancement, to say that as a better word, it's very hard for older people to learn those things and to change the way they did things before. So I think society then relegates older people as not as adaptable or knowledgeable about what the needs are in the present moment.
Absolutely, Loretta. And that says something about priorities. Does that mean that technology is the only important, significant element of life? You know, just as when somebody becomes older, doesn't have the same physical prowess, is that how you measure a person? Just because physically?
But I think
maybe a little weaker.
But there also may be, going back to, for example, the agricultural revolution. People may not have adapted to the machinery that was invented to use in the field, so they still prefer to do it the other way. And I still know people, even younger people, who said, my mother always did it this way, I like to do it this way. So
well, there is something positive about that.
Yeah, of course there is. But I'm just saying, as a society, they then relegate the older people as not being adaptable.
No, it's totally anti our tradition. Totally. I thought I heard a voice that I haven't heard yet today, maybe.
Sipora has her hand up.
Oh, you I'm know, not seeing that, Sipora. Okay.
I've been waving at you.
Go ahead, Sipora.
I have
respect for my elder.
Yeah, respect, that's you better. That's it. I had an aunt who, when she retired, and it was a forced retirement, and she was 65, it was the most liberating experience. She had always dreamed of going to university and never could. So at 65, she enrolled at the University of Toronto and sat with the 18-year-olds in a Canadian history class. And as they're discussing the 1930s and everything that was going on, these kids were looking at her saying, well, how do you know all this? And she said, I lived through it. And it was the most inspiring old age that anyone could choose to do.
Thank you. That leads us into our very next text, because no one is trying to say that you should work until you can no longer work, because there is much else to do in life. Look what Tamara Mantwiel says. Heschel believed that there should be serious senior universities. And some of you go on these, whether it's a term or whether it's a week in nature, etc., should be serious senior universities to foster continued intellectual engagement and skill re-education for the elderly. This would have the added benefit of giving the middle-aged and the young the impression that seniors are capable of growth.
But
the
most
goal, he contended, is not to keep the old man or woman busy. You know, give them something to do. No, but it is to remind the older person that every moment is an opportunity for greatness.
But I think most universities do have special adult education courses.
Okay, but remember, he's writing this a while ago, but he's trying to make the point that is so relevant to our society that is not encouraging that. Yes, we do hear of people who go back to school, but if the young have to appreciate that. And more importantly, as one gets older, as I said earlier, he or she has to believe that it's not the final curtain. You can't live like that.
Yeah, but what's very, very important is that as you get older, that you try to study something completely new, because your mind is like an elastic and the part of your mind is dormant. So let's say I'm an avid reader, but I can read 20 hours a day and it will not improve my mind. But if I learn something completely new, so the dormant part of the mind takes over. And so I'm forever trying to learn something new.
Interesting. Okay, now we have models. Tzipora just mentioned her, did you say aunt?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Our tradition has models. Look at in Bamidbar, as Moshe is once again saying, it is too difficult for him to do this on his own. So God does not turn him toward the young bucks, but alone I cannot carry this entire people, for it is too hard for me. If this is the way you treat me, please kill me if I have found favor in your eyes, so that I not see my misfortune. And God responds, then the Lord said to Moshe, assemble for me 70 men of the elders of Israel, Zaken, Skenim, whom you know to be the people's elders and officers, and you shall take them to the tent of meeting, and they shall stand there with you.
But the Torah doesn't accept elders, it's elders in mind. It doesn't have to be elder in age.
Yes, but in this case, it actually meant people who had the wisdom because of life's experience. Okay, now, let's look very briefly at these three characters, continuing with Moshe. So toward the end of his life, and as he's saying goodbye to the people he's been with for so long, he has been a lawgiver. What else has he been to them, to Bnei Israel, the Israelites?
Well, he's been
before he was a lawgiver, Marlene?
He's been like a miracle worker, and he's also been like a father.
Yes, a liberator from Egypt and throughout this way, he has been, because a father is helpful and can also be very demanding. But in the end, Moshe could have looked back and focused on his achievements, and he could have focused and brooded about failures. But instead, until he actually leaves us, he continues to teach Bnei Israel, trying to prepare them for their new life in Canaan, in the promised land. And that's why, what do we actually call him? Moshe Rabbeinu. What is Rabbeinu? Our rabbi. And what is a rabbi? It really means teacher. So till he leaves, he is growing and he is being significant. If we remember Megillat Rut, Naomi, who has every reason to give up on life, she went with her husband who betrayed his people in Beit Lechem, and she loses her husband, she loses her two sons, and that could have been it. But she goes back to her homeland, and you could say, well, it would be more comfortable. But she doesn't just leave it at that. She is a mentor to Ruth. And another example, what am I going to say about Akiva? Anyone who shows you get older, but that doesn't mean you don't grow. What is it about Akiva, Rabbi Akiva?
He started learning when he was 40.
He started learning and learning how to read.
And he didn't have the confidence in himself. It was his wife who pushed him.
I have to be honest. Nachama just finished reading an actual novel. about his life, which I highly recommend. What I don't book? Think it's in English, by Yochi Brandis, who takes biblical or Talmudic narratives and puts them in. And I'm in the midst of reading it now too. So these are examples. Now,
did you say the name of the book?
Akiva. We're familiar with this line that we say as we're approaching, fast approaching, Yamim Noraim, the days of all. Al tashlicheni le'eit zikna. Now look at these two different, slightly translations. Do not cast me off in the time of old age, or let us not be thrust into a time where we are aged. Read those two to yourself and tell me what's the difference.
One might be from an internal belief and the others from outside, from others doing it to you.
Ah, nice. Anybody else?
Age is a matter of mind, and if you don't mind, it won't matter. Internal strength.
Okay. Anyone else?
I'm looking at the word thrust.
Okay.
I mean, let's age gradually.
Okay. Let us age gradually. Well, I want you to listen.
Also, it replies assumption that when we are older, we can be cast aside, that we don't have the value.
Okay, and that's certainly what we have talked about today. But Rav Uri Lipschitz, and I couldn't find a translation, but I've cut out some parts, but just kept the essence as it's relevant for our discussion, said beautifully, and how he interprets this line. Kriyato Shalabesh, the Baal Shem Tov, gave a new and fresh interpretation to this line. He says that it is a prayer to God not to throw us into a period of zikna, of old age. Now, what does that mean, a period of old age? There is a place like this. My consciousness and what's going on in my soul at any time can be old age. Now, this is a situation where we have let ourselves feel obsolete, and that we have lost enthusiasm and passion. And our prayer should be that no matter what age, that we will feel inspired and that we will inspire. And if we were enthusiastic about something in particular 40 years ago, that we should remain as passionate. I mean, certain things, I guess we don't want to, they might, whatever, but that passion should never leave a person, no matter what age. And that we have to realize we don't have control over time. That's one of the few things we don't have control over.
But we have control.
But we do have the ability to find the strengths to live every moment and with passion. And we'll just close with one paragraph from Naomi Shemer's Life's Wisdom. And this is a paragraph to conclude all four sessions. For whatever stage, whether it was childhood, adolescence, adulthood, and old age, whatever stage, there are going to be difficulties in every one of those stages. And we all know that. And so the wisdom that our great composer shared with us, and we all know this, is no matter what, Lakum machar baboker im shir chadash balev, lashir oto bekoach, lashir oto bichev, lishmoa tzilim beruach hachofshit, ulatchil mibreshit.
Yofi.
To wake up tomorrow morning with a new song in our hearts, to sing it with strength, to sing it with pain, to hear the flutes, the chalilim, and the free breeze, and to start from the beginning.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen, amen.
Yeah. You every day a clean slate.
Without, as we have said, leaving behind what has come before. Remember, that was one of the most important points, I think, of that we build on each stage. Yes.
You said it in last week's session. Of course, Naomi Shemer says it even better, but to bring the innocence.
Excuse me?
The innocence, the curiosity, and the exuberance. If you bring that with you, then you're irrepressible. But it's hard sometimes because people are, you know, there are things that weigh people down. So it's a big challenge.
If you haven't figured that out yet, Linda, of course it is. Of course it is. Now, hold on one second. I just happen to have a glass here because I bought something. They gave it to me at Fox. If you want to fly, give up everything that weighs you down. But that's not realistic, is it? Is it? And most importantly, we talked about being intellectual and using our mind. Well, even at this age that I'm at, my sister managed to get me back into Pilates twice a week, starting last week.
Good for you.
She told me she was shocked when she saw what I could do.
Talking about mine, I must share a funny line. I'm reading a book now called Five Minds, which is people who are top of the line in psychology and so on. And the psychologist starts with a statement, and I'm still laughing at. He has no tolerance for people who have no tolerance.
Very good. But I'm going to conclude. There is an older woman who wants her portrait done. She invites the artist, and he paints, and then when she takes a look, she sees that it's not her. She says to him, "Why have you taken out all of my wrinkles?" He said, "I thought you'd prefer it." She said, "You put every one of those wrinkles back. I earned them."
That's right.
Anyway, I will not be seeing you for the next 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. Those of you who are doing the Women's League on the 7th, enjoy. And those of you who aren't, also enjoy, and make sure that you make the most of each moment so that when we reach old age, long time from now, we'll know how to handle it. Okay. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Bracha.
Thank you.